for the invitation. I'm going to try to give you some of the enthusiasm that I have to one star, our closest star, and some of the really neat things that we see. As said, what we do, what the coronagraph does is creates an artificial eclipse by putting out a disk out in front of the objective lens, which, because it's close to the observer, you can't see far, you can't see very close into the disk itself. The further away you go, the closer you can see into the disk. And so with the moon is a perfect location, so you can really see quite close to the disk of the sun. And I'll talk a little bit about what is a coronagraph. Some of the earlier instruments, and then the currently flying coronagraphs are the Sub-Alaska one, which was launched in 1995 and is still operating. The Stereo Secchi coronagraph was launched in 2006, and then the new instruments are going to go closer than we've ever gone. The one instrument will go, one spacecraft will go to 0.28 AU, a third of the way toward the sun. And the other one will go to about 10 solar radii, about 4 million miles from the disk of the sun. So, the evolution of the coronagraph. So, the coronagraph was made possible in the 30s by a Frenchman, Bernard Leault, who looked at the various reasons why the telescopes were getting so much light into them. And what he did was he discovered that there are three sources of light, that if he could get rid of them, or in fact he proposes how to get rid of them. The first is, well, if we skip the top one, which is an externally occulted coronagraph, if we go to the bottom two, he created the bottom one, for example, there's an edge here, or this edge is what he would have. That edge created, there's diffraction coming off of that edge, and so he developed this stuff, which we call A3, or popularly is the Leault stuff, named after him, which captures, which is a little bit smaller than the aerial image of the A1 aperture. And so that captures this diffraction ring, the very bright ring that's occurring around that star. So he also had an occulting disk, but not at this location, but at the focal plane. But the point was that he has these various lenses, each one imaging a different part of the system onto another aperture that then reduces the scattered light. So for the externally occulted coronagraph, which was developed in the 60s, a series of disks or something was put out in front of the objective lens, which is the O1. And the diffracted light from each disk is capturing a little bit of the diffracted light from the preceding disk. And so what gets into this aperture, into the A1 aperture, is only light coming from the last disk. It then gets imaged by this O1 lens. That disk gets imaged onto the occulter, which is that little black spot there called D2, and then the diffraction from this edge, the entrance aperture, gets imaged onto the field stop, and then this lens images the A1 aperture onto A3, and then finally the relay lens just creates an image of the proper size. in the 70s and 80s, the first orbiting coronagraph was launched in 71, which is actually when I started at NRL for that mission. And it was a very small telescope of 30 inches long. The aperture was about half an inch. The detector was 256 pixels by 256 pixels, or 65 kilobytes. And it only operated, the bit rate was 200 bits per second. The disadvantage was that it really could only observe in the window of about 6 hours a day. In 73, a large manned mission, the Skylab mission, had a large coronagraph that went from about two to six radii. The OSO coronagraph went from 3 to 10. You know, about roughly the same region of space. The Skylab was film detector. OSO 7 was an SEC Vidicon, secondary electrode conduction Vidicon. It's very similar to the TV tubes that were in vogue at that time, in the television cameras. But because it was film, because Skylab was film, they couldn't observe a lot they were limited by their film capacity, so that was an issue. The flight spare instrument for OSO 7 was launched on an Air Force Space Test Program, P-78-1, called Solwing, and it operated from 79 to 85, but in fact, in 85, it was used as the target for, Reagan was having a meeting with Gorbachev, and he wanted something to illustrate his Star Wars program, the Strategic Defense Initiative, as it was called. And so they used this spacecraft, which was aging, it had lost the last of its three tape recorders, its batteries were having troubles, and so it was really declining. So they used it as the target for that, and you could show that to Gorbachev. And then finally, the Solar Maximum mission was launched in 1980. It had an issue. But then got recovered and worked from 84 to 89. But these were all sort of precursors. They were all in Earth orbit, and that was turned out to be a major issue. There are a number of, but the first OSO 7 was launched in October, in September, late part of September. In December, it observed the very first coronal mass ejection. No idea of such an eruption had been thought of. The idea was that from the ground, there were lots of measurements, observations of material. Prominences going up, but then they would see the prominences draining back down. And so they had no concept that something like that could leak. And in fact, OSO 7 then showed that was possible. And so Skylab modified their observing program to be able to, when one of these was detected, to be able to follow it. And then that was, then Solwyn, that was the primary objective, was that to try to see these all the time. SMM was just a follow-on to the Skylab mission in a sense, but also to look at seeing the coronal mass ejections as they were called. So some early results. This is in fact the first CME. These are 256 square images, and luckily the instrument was put into a highly highly compressed mode and had various modes of data compression. One was to take only a quadrant. The other was to actually do something called run length encoding, where you send down the intensity of the first pixel, and then you count the number of pixels that are within a delta. You could specify what the delta was of that original pixel. And so compression is a fairly high. And so you can see how high rates you could see. In the top three images, they were all this run length encoding. The bottom images were the full resolution, but a quadrant mode. And you could see, you know, things were changing dramatically. It looked like that bright structure that is called the streamer just sort of blew up, and what followed was tracked. So this is one. This is another version. This is from the Solar Maximum Mission coronagraph that flew in 1980. And what they recognized was a three-part structure. And so here you see it. You see this bright ring, a cavity, and then the bright prominence material coming out. We call it prominence material. Here it is, because it looks like a prominence, but nobody really knows that. We don't call it an H alpha because we don't see it emitting an H alpha. Another new thing was that this observation of what was called the halo. And this is one where the event is coming at the observer. And so this was proof that these events are actually quite have a very large three-dimensional extent. And so you can see it, you can see the boundary of it just going out, and finally it's covering the whole detector. Well, this was a big event. This was a big deal, because now in the same mission, this P78 one Solwyn, a study was made of that every fast mass ejection was related to a shock in the planetary space. There was a one-to-one relationship. Every shock was that way, and everything was related to every fast CME. And so what that meant was that we could snap to, this was really, we could now say what was happening on Earth. Or you could see the cause of geomagnetic storms, the cause of the aurora, were due to these things. So there were a lot of other events, a lot of other results, but I didn't want to get into everything. So we're moving now to the SOHO LASCO. SOHO is the Solar and Heliospheric Observatory. It was a European Space Agency spacecraft, and LASCO was built by us, by NRL. And it was the largest continuous view of the corona. It was continuous because it went to the L1 Lagrangian point. So Lagrange had calculated that around any big body, there are six points of gravitational interest. Some have gravitational minima, some are sort of inflection points in the gravitational field. The L1 is a million miles ahead of Earth toward the Sun, and just goes with it. It was with the Earth as it orbits the Sun, but you're in continuous sunlight then. We're out of the magnetosphere, and so you're able to observe continuously. All the low Earth satellites, unless you're in the dawn-dusk orbit, but most of the NASA standard orbit had a day-night cycle, and so for about half, which was about, let's say, 100 minutes long, for about half of that cycle, about half of that time, you can't observe. You're either at night or you're in the region of the atmosphere where there's too much atmosphere and you get too much scattered light. So you only have about 50 minutes. And so you go into orbit night and you come into dawn, and the corona looks completely different. So the last go allowed us to some position allowed us to do that. So the results are that it established, there were three, first of all, there were three spacecraft, I mean three instruments in the LASCO packet. An internally occulted coronagraph, which allows you to get down to 1.1 solar radii, and then the externally occulted ones begin further out. And so with each of them, you can see the closer in you go, which means that you can't see very far out into the corona because the stray light dominates then. And so by going out to 3.7 solar radii, we could finally see out to 30 solar radii, which is, we're now talking, quarter of a degree. So that's almost 8 degrees from the sun. So the three major events, or major results, one was that it established CMEs as the dominant driver of the non-periodic space weather. During solar activity minimum, there are co-rotating interaction regions which come around every month, and they also contribute to the space weather, to aurora and other issues. But the CMEs produce the strongest storms. It's the most prolific comet finder in history. And it defined the structure of the CME to be a magnetic flux rope. This is a flux rope. This is a structure that has a current flowing through it, and you get a magnetic field around that current, and it's the current is running along this loop. This is a sped up version of 2 years from LASCO, the first 2 years actually, which went from solar activity minimum to maximum. And you can see that the structure was at a dipole-like structure. That was the Milky Way that just went by. The structure changes, these bright streamers, as they're called, these are regions of higher density, higher electron density than the rest of the region. And it's being channeled that way by the solar magnetic field. So as at minimum, you've got the field of the sun is dominated by the dipole field. At maximum, it has quadrupolar and octopolar components, and so the structures become all over. We're still at minimum, 90s, we're approaching, we're in between the absolute minimum and max. And you can see that this, you can start to see the motion of the structures going above the poles as they transit from one limb to the other. There's the Milky Way again. And you can see that was probably Venus. Mercury and I guess Jupiter. So it's really quite an amazing thing. And then in June of 98, SOHO was lost, and due to operational errors, the pointing, they were doing some tests, and the pointing, they were spinning up something to test the magnetometers to calibrate them, and the angular momentum, it got so high that the angular momentum, the pointing on the spacecraft flipped so that the principal moment of inertia was now pointed along the spin axis. And so that meant that the arrays were now 90 degrees from where they should have been, and they were sort of rotating in an odd way. And it took almost 6 months before that was fixed. So this is the first observation of what was called the flux rope CME. And you get the feeling that this structure, you're seeing through this loop into either before or behind the what we call the plane of the sky. And that was really the first time that was seen. Here's another instance of it. And you see this structure here, this is where it's primarily in the plane, but then it's continuing in the back. and toward the rear, so to speak.
We can't say for sure.
This is, shows just a movie of a CME moving out in solar, at solar maximum. I think this is 2001. So it is continuing to work well. Space is kind of a there are a lot of energetic particles in space, and there's a rate, and the average background rate is six energetic particles per square centimeter per second. When a big mass ejection occurs or a flare, there are a lot more energetic particles, and they brown your optics. So the browning of the optics causes a loss of sensitivity. You get less light on the detector. So this instrument suffers about 0.5% per year degradation in its sensitivity. And we know that because we use stars to count the past transits of stars through the fields of view to correct the calibration. So here's just a nice image that puts the two externally occulted coronagraphs and the UV imager in together, and you get the sense of what's happening in this corona. That was a huge CME. They're really large. They go out. The fastest one we've seen is on the order of 3,000 kilometers per second. And they travel out in a cone, generally. And if Earth is in that cone, we see it. If we're not in that cone, we don't see it. And so so it's really that has made this instrument really important for allowing the NOAA Space Environment Lab, for example, which is charged with, has the responsibility for issuing alerts of major events to the electric power industry, for example, to oil and gas prospectors that are used mainly cognitives to locate possible areas where there's deposits of oil and gas. But they use that data to stop their operations. The sun is, LASCO has been this fantastic comet watch. Because it's seeing stuff coming so close to the sun, there's a group of comets, the Kreutz sun grazers, which are basically dark until they get close enough to the sun that the heat is starting to warm them up, and they start to give off particles. The ice starts to melt or whatever it is. And so I just wanted to show this because there are two comets that are coming in, both sun grazers, but they're in different orbits. And so that's saying that all the Kreutz is not a single orbit. There are many, many sub orbits. NASA put together a graphic that shows all of the, I think this was for the 3,000th comet discovery. And so all the Kreutz objects are in red here. They all come from the south, and the ones that are labeled are of course, like NEAT, and you're seeing the planets come by. There are other ecliptic kind of comets, but it's really been an amazing instrument. Yeah, they seem to come in groups. So all of these Kreutz originated from a single comet object. 4,000 years ago, maybe, And it broke up in its first transit around the sun into smaller objects. And some of these are visible from the ground. There was one in 66, and the great comet of 1888 was that way. But these are much, much smaller, this population that we're measuring now. And you only see them brighten up at around, say, 15 solar radii. And then by 2 solar radii, they're completely gone. So this is comet Machholz. You may have heard of that. It just had an apparition recently. This is it. It's not a Kreutz, and so it's coming in from a different point. But then you can see it's fading out as it's going up to the top. It really disappeared. So you can see the dust tail. There's the ion tail,
yeah.
And then after it went through perihelion, these are all seen coronal mass ejections occurring at solar max, and then by the time it got out to the edge, it's really a nothing. So now I'll turn to the STEREO spacecraft, and the SECI instrument, the SECI coronagraph, and this is really. STEREO, our LASCO, went to 8 degrees, plus or minus 8 degrees from the sun. STEREO sees all the way from sun to Earth. So that was its first, that was its big thing. But there were 5 telescopes that then covered the UV image of the sun, and then a series of 4 white light telescopes that went further out. And this is just a depiction of it. So AHEAD was targeted to go out to the ahead of Earth, and its average perihelion is less than Earth's perihelion, and so that means that it goes faster than Earth. It's in orbit about the sun. The behind spacecraft has a slightly greater perihelion, and so it goes slower than Earth. And they drifted at about 22.5 degrees per year from Earth. And so combining the two spacecraft, you could, if you were out in space, you were seeing all the way from one arm to the other arm. You're seeing this whole region of space, the whole hemisphere. One of the things that it did was it improved on, this is a halo mass ejection. So this is one that was coming toward us. And if you remember, the very first one we saw was not, it was 256 square. This is 1024 squared, so it's a lot better, a lot more resolution. And then this is the prominence material, and it's coming from a region on the disk. And so it's completely, that emission, and because it's coming out in this cone, the emission is completely surrounding. When it gets far enough out, it completely surrounds the cone disk. So this is where the STEREO spacecraft are now. Here's Earth. Sun, A is over there. What happened was they went completely around and then they switched, and now AHEAD is coming toward Earth, coming around this way, and behind us is coming the other direction. The problem was that when they went behind the sun, they were out of communication with Earth. And so for about a year, we didn't have communication with the spacecraft. And there was a failure on B just as they lost contact. And so B has not been recovered yet. The comet Encke was coming in. There it is, right there. And the solar wind is just blowing all by it. You can see the tail is getting disrupted. And now this big CME is going to come. Or did it already come?
Yeah,
and the tail, this is Encke only has an ion tail. So when the big front of the CME, there it is, when it crosses, the tail gets disrupted. And it's a reconnection between the field around Encke with the field in the coronal mass ejection. We've just been doing is looking at the these images, that colored image there in the center, is what they're actually being seen by that last telescope. That's a raw image, or almost a raw image. And what you're seeing, these isotopes, are isotopes of brightness, but it's what we call the F corona, the Fraunhofer corona, or the dust corona, or the zodiacal light, depending on exactly what your perspective is. And what we measured was the axis of symmetry of the dust corona. And on the right plot, it's plotted in the coordinate system, which is the first point of Aries. And all 6 years are overlying each other on these three plots. The three different colors represent three different points in the field of view. From close to the sun to far from the sun. And so we looked at that, and we analyzed what the inclination of the plane is, and you can see that initially it's fairly flat, which is the gravitational force, and it agrees with what measurements from Earth down to about 0.3 AU of the orbit of Mercury. But then, at some point, it takes off. And that's due to the dust being charged and the solar magnetic field is creating the so-called Lorentz force, J cross B, and it's causing the inclination of the orbit to change. And it's becoming more solar-like. The other thing is that not only that's happening, but the dust orbits are becoming circular, and that's being shown here, that this Poynting-Robertson, which is a force due to the light's energy of the momentum impacting the dust particle and causing it to change its orbit. Both there are two. What we did the lower latitudes and the positive latitudes, we did them separately. I didn't spell things very well. And both of them are plotted here on this plot. So they really are overlapping each other really very, very well. But the thing that was really startling was that when we looked at the intensities, it was really obvious that the low latitude intercepts, which, so you could plot, if you plot the intensity in a log-log plot, it's really quite a good straight line. And so we characterized it with two parameters, the slope and the intercept. And that's this, and the intercept then is different for the negative latitudes versus the positive latitudes. And that's due to the fact that the center of the dust cloud is not at the center of the sun, but is shifted by 4 arc minutes in the direction of Jupiter, as it turns out, in the direction of Jupiter. During the 6 years that we did these observations, Jupiter was always on the same side in this in the Taurus. In fact, the mass of the whole solar system is one solar radius. What we see, so by comparing these observations, which are from 4 degrees to 24 degrees from the sun, with observations taken further out and ones that are taken in the infrared beyond 1 AU, that this parameter is different for every set of observations. That every planet is apparently imposing its field, its gravitational field, on the dust as it comes through. This slopes are virtually the same, except at two points. The one on the right, the rise on the right, is really due to just errors with the Milky Way. The Milky Way is in the field at that time, and we had trouble. So it's an increased noise.
It's just noise.
It's just noise.
Yeah.
But the one here in the center is right at the line of nose. And so we don't understand. We're not sure. But it could be that there's a very narrow dust distribution in the ecliptic that when you get above or below it, you don't see it. But if you're right on that line, you do see that increase or decrease actually in the slope. So, in the last few minutes, I'd like to talk about leaving WINAU on these two missions that are going to explore the inner heliosphere, the Parker Solar Probe and Solar Orbiter. The Parker Probe is a NASA-only mission, and that's the one that will go, that will launch next July, well, the window is July to mid-August, and it'll go just screaming into the sun. 3 months later, 3 months after its launch, we are at 35 solar radii, that's 9 degrees. That's just amazing. So we're at the edge of where the LASCO coronagraph ended. We're just beyond that. That's really going to be amazing. Then finally, after a few years of using Venus as gravity assists, it will get down to just inside of 10 solar radii. So, as it was, the APL people would like to say, if you had a football field 100 yards, you would be at the 4-yard line. So this is the spacecraft. It does it. It was originally proposed in 1959, but the technology really wasn't there. And almost every decade, it's been proposed, re-proposed. And I remember going to a meeting about 1980, when it was being, the idea of it was being proposed, and people were saying, oh, well, we just can't do it. But the key was that there's a heat shield. It's a heat shield made of carbon-carbon, just like an epoxy, but they bake it out, so it's only carbon-carbon. It's very lightweight, it weighs 75 pounds. It was coated with a ceramic layer on the front, but it's only about 75 pounds. It's very, even though it's 6 feet wide, it's basically 6 feet circle, it's very, very light. That white stuff in the front is our cooling arrays. The solar arrays, which are here, and there's one on the other side, fold back, and I think they also turn, but they are water cooled, and so those are the cooling to allow for that. There are some instruments that are outside of the protection of the heat shield. The field's antennae, which are measuring electromagnetic waves, and then there's a Faraday cup on the other side, which is measuring the low energy particles, the solar wind particles. There's an energetic particle swoop thing that's measuring the field, the magnetic field, and then this is energetic particles again. So there are only four instruments, and none can look at the sun. So this is the spacecraft in Vibe that was done at Hopkins at the Applied Physics Lab. It's now at removed just this, what, I think it was Monday maybe, moved over to Goddard to do the rest of the environmental testing, acoustic tests and thermal. it to the tape. So it's really on schedule for launching next July. But this was a simulation, this was a calculation, using the stereo data of the orbit. And it's sort of a fake. We're not going underneath, we're going around. So one of the questions, just to sort of give to, is that we've been wondering, we're going into a new region. We've never been there before. What are we going to see? So one of the issues is, are these streamers, these things that look like, you know, these bright regions that are coming out from the disk that are tracing the magnetic field lines. They are where, they are actually where the field is changing from being inwardly directed to outwardly directed. And so it's this boundary, or the neutral sheet. And we wonder what's happening there. What might we see? And so we said, well, let's say that the streamer is actually filled. If you look at the sun, in the disk of the sun, you see all these magnetic field lines that are going out. Suppose the field lines are being directed into this plasma sheet, which is sort of what the MHC modeling is telling us. Suppose that those structures are still present out at the outer distances. And so as we're flying through this thing, you're flying through a snowstorm in a sense. So as you get closer, the particles, your resolution starts increasing. That when it's far away, everything is bunched together, but as you get closer, they spread apart. And so you really are in a very wonderful situation. It's really neat. So this was just to show that, yes, we're going to see something that is really spaced. These are quite fine, and you can distinguish them as they fly. Another thing that is going to be discovered, I think, is that back in 1929, Henry Norris Russell, a very famous astronomer, predicted that there's a dust-free zone around the sun out to about 4 or 5 solar radii. So people have been looking for that from Earth during eclipses, during rockets, whatever, and never found any evidence for it. So this is a plot of the integrand of an integral of the dust. So depending, the observer is at 0 and the sun is at 1. And so depending upon your location, the epsilon, depending upon the angle that you're looking at, you will see more or less dust. You can see that much of the dust, close to the sun, much of the dust is originating close to the sun. And so what that's saying is that your observations that you're making of the dust, you're in fact having to look through this huge path length, and you're not, you just can't distinguish it. You don't have enough sensitivity to see the absence. You can see that we can in fact see it. The purple line is the original. What we'll be seeing is this blue line up here in this curve, and then the black line is the electron. So the other instrument is the SOHI instrument on ESA's Solar Orbiter mission. I won't go into it. It is probably not launching in 2019. It's probably launching in 2020. And so invite me back.